All right, let's talk about memory management, and specifically memory management as the kernel relates to memory management. Recall the traditional computer architecture. We have a CPU, we have memory, there's some sort of interaction with disk, with the network, et cetera, but what does this really, really look like? Well, in a computer, there's one stick or two sticks or some finite sticks of RAM, but there can be hundreds and hundreds of processes, and each process has a virtual memory space that you might find familiar with this slide from the fundamentals lectures, from the actually embryo ASM lectures now, where, you know, as you've now seen quite a bit, Every process has the binary loaded somewhere, the libraries loaded somewhere, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? But again, you have only one physical memory, and you can only have one physical address of hex 40100 in the case of a non-position dependent code, right? So how would you load multiple programs into memory in a way that they wouldn't clobber each other? Right. One solution, of course, position-dependent code. This is what libraries do. You can load libraries anywhere. They figure the heck out. But that still doesn't give you isolation. One library can mess with another library pretty easily, right? So we came up with the concept of virtual memory. And actually, now I have to make a note to myself to add some historical context here. Virtual memory, these concepts came out around the 60s is where the literature is that I first started seeing these musings on, hey, maybe we should make sure that one process can't clobber memory space of another process and so forth, right? And virtual memory provides views for different processes into physical memory. The physical memory is one big long stick of RAM, and the virtual memory is views that every process has into it. And the kernel, in collaboration with architectures and features of the CPU, maintains mappings between the virtual addresses and the physical addresses. All right, so how might you do this? Well, one easy way is say, okay, hey, every process gets, let's say, 4 kilobytes of memory, OX from 0 to XFFF. And their entire a virtual memory space gets mapped in somewhere from some base into physical memory. So you say, oh, okay, I know that P1, I just add hex 1000, or P2, I just add hex 1000, and that's where it is in virtual memory. And so the translations are easy, the processes work, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But then what if the process 2 needs more memory? Well, our solution was, hey, we allow for memory, continuous memory in the virtual memory space of a process to be non-contiguous in the physical memory space of a process. So on this page-by-page basis of hex 1,000 bytes, everything is contiguous in physical memory. But in virtual memory, everything's contiguous for this hex 1,000 bytes for one page in both physical and virtual memory, but continuous virtual pages might be completely randomly set aside in physical memory as available. And we had to do this because, as you saw here, process 2 requested more memory and it was right up against the memory of process 3. So we couldn't just keep it contiguous. We could have moved process 3, expanded process 2, but that's expensive. You know, all of this memory moving and stuff, just not so great. So now we have this problem where, hey, we have to track all of this shit, right? We have to figure out, hey, page 1 of process 1 is actually here in physical memory. Page 2 of process 1 is here, and so forth. And so sometime way back when, lost in the historical record, we have a report that someone's done with level 1. Let's see. Boom! One solve of level 1. Congratulations, H. Cree. Big surprise. All right, the race is on. So, sometime way back when, in the birth of the process even, we created this concept of page tables. And the idea is, for every page, which is a contiguous chunk of hex 1000, of 4096 bytes, 4 kilobytes, we figure out and track, sorry, in the page table, the physical address of that page, right? And each page table, because we have now started talking about memory in terms of pages, and we have actually been talking about memory in terms of pages this whole time, and that's not an accident, each page table holds 512 entries. Why? Because hex 1000 divided by 8, right now we have 8 byte addresses, 64-bit, is 512. That's how many entries fit in one page, and a page table takes up one page for spiritual reasons, but also implementation and performance reasons. All right, so this allows us to hold 512 pages each, 512, yes, pages in the page table. Each page contains hex 1000, 4 kilobytes of memory that adds up to 2 megabytes. So now each process with a page table can have 2 megabytes of memory, and this memory doesn't have to be contiguous in physical in the physical memory, but it's contiguous in the virtual address space. Amazing. But there's a problem. Of course, we need more than 2 megabytes of RAM. Libc needs more than 2 megabytes of RAM, right? Like, you know, even if we just have a hello world that has a memory footprint nowadays of more than 2 megabytes of RAM, it wasn't always like that. We used to be careful with our memory, but now we are not. And I blame Connor. No, I'm just kidding. But we definitely need more than 2 megs of RAM. Come on. The Linux kernel itself takes up like 700 megabytes of RAM. It's ridiculous. I mean, that's probably not all loaded into memory at all times, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But if you look at the uncompressed VM Linux image, it's pretty big. Okay. Chrome is gigantic too. Don't get me started on Chrome. Obviously, we need more than 2 megs. So, what did the architecture designers in their infinite wisdom do? Well, they said, hey, well, this page table thing works pretty well. What if I put a page table in your page table? So you could page while you page. So, we did exactly that. We created the concept of page directories. And by we, I mean society. And page directories have entries that point to page tables that have entries that point to pages in physical memory. And this pointer is the physical address of a page table, by the way. So it can just all be nicely resolved. A page directory contains 512 page directory entries because every entry is 8 bytes, and a page directory takes up one page because memory is managed in pages, right? Which means 512 times 2 megabytes is 1 gigabyte of addressable virtual memory. Who would need anything more, right? This has some overhead, right? For every 2 megabytes of memory, we need a page table, which page table takes up a page. So it takes 4 kilobytes for every 2 megabytes of RAM, plus it takes 4 kilobytes for the page directory itself. That starts getting a little bit uncomfortable. That's like 2 megabytes of memory overhead for every gig. Not insane, but you know, people get nervous. So they said, okay, hey, well, we can reduce the overhead a little bit with a special flag. And you'll notice all of these last few bytes are all zeros because, of course, we're addressing pages. So there's plenty of space, 12 bits per entry here for flags. By setting a flag, a page directory entry, instead of referring to a page table, can just refer to a what's called a large page, 2 megabytes of contiguous physical memory. Cool. All right, so now we've solved the problem. We can go up to 1 gigabyte, which would be great if we were living in the year 2000. Like the Jetsons. The Jetsons probably only had page directories. But we are not the Jetsons. No matter how much we want to be the Jetsons, we can't. We don't even have flying cars. Maybe if we had flying cars, we could fit into a gigabyte of RAM. But we don't have flying cars. So instead, we put a page directory in your page directory so you could page while you page while you page. Boom! We created a page directory page table, and by we, I mean society again, that contains 512, excuse me, page directory pointers addressing a total of 512 gigabytes of RAM, right? Now, of course, this has insane amounts of overhead. Every, every page directory represents overhead, and every page table represents overhead, and so forth. But if it's, you know, percentage-wise, it's minuscule, but people still said, okay, well, hey, if you're nervous about that overhead, don't worry, by setting a special flag in the page directory page table entry, it can refer to what's called a huge page. We went from large page now to huge page, which is a 1 gigabyte contiguous space of memory, instead of a page directory. Cool? Very cool. All right. So, as someone mentioned, 512 gigabytes might now be enough to open a second tab in Chrome. But what if you want to open a third tab? You're fucked. In the old days of page directory page tables, you're screwed. How are you going to open another tab? Well, people said, okay, you want more RAM? You want more RAM? You can have more RAM. We're going to put a page directory page table in your page directory page table so you could page while you page while you page while you page. And this brings us to the modern world of 4 levels of paging structures that created the page map level 4, which contains 512 PDPT entries, which point to a page directory page table, which point to page directories, which point to page tables, allowing us to address a theoretical 256 terabytes of RAM. Now, I'm not aware of computers that have 256 terabytes of RAM, but you can get rent computers from Amazon that have multiple terabytes of RAM. So this isn't just theoretical. This is used in practice. It's important stuff. If you think about it, and think about some amount of storage space that seems a little high, like 256 terabytes, probably in a decade, that will be an amount of memory, RAM, that seems just a little high. And in 2 decades, is going to be an amount of RAM that seems low. And that's how it was before, right? At some point, a gigabyte of RAM seemed like insanity. In high school, there was a crazy economical, a crazy situation where RAM became insanely cheap. I bought gigabytes of RAM in 512 meg sticks for all the computers in my family. And I loaded my main workstation with 1.5 gigabytes of RAM, which was insane. And Windows 98 refused to boot. So think about that. I didn't know that you could get terabytes of RAM in the 2040 MacBook Pro. Lol. Yes, exactly. So, okay, anyways. So yeah, that was really actually very frustrating because Linux worked just fine, but suddenly I couldn't play games anymore. So I ended up actually downgrading to 768 megs of RAM, which was the most that Windows could take on my hardware. It was really annoying. Anyway, so this is the modern world. This is the world you all live in, is the world of PML4. And it gets even worse, but I'll get to that in a second. All right, so PML level 4 is pretty awesome. What does this, how do we actually index into all of these tables? What does a virtual address actually do? So I pulled this virtual address. This is a stack address when I did cat proc self maps, right? Just some stack address. Let's take a look at how it actually gets translated into the into a physical address, right? We take 12 bits as an index into the page table, and then 9 bits at a time from 0 to 512 as indexes into the different levels of the four-level paging structure. The first 9 bits, the leftmost 9 bits here, are an index into the PML4, into here. Then the next 9 bits are an index into the PDPT to select the PD. The next 9 bits are an index into the PD to select the PT, the page table. And then the next 9 bits are an index into the page table to select the actual page. And then the next 12 bits are an index into the page from 0 to hex FFF. So when you access some memory in your program, move RAX, dereference RBX, this actually does 4 different memory dereferences to bring you the actual page and let you do that dereference. Now, recall that processes are isolated. So it gets even crazier because, hey, guess what? Each virtual address space, each process has its own PML4, right? So how do you actually specify where the PML4 is? Because so far, we've had this circular thing because where the PT is specified by the PD entry, where the PD is specified by the PDPT entry, where the PDPT is specified by the PML4 entry. Where's the PML4? Well, that is specified by a register called the CR3 register. It is a special register, controlled register, that's what CR stands for, only accessible in ring 0. I've mentioned it in the kernel lecture, one of the earlier kernel lectures, but now you know in depth how it's used. There are other control registers. Some of them set processor options. Some of them are used for other crazy things. There's a lot of craziness in x86. It's incredible. I learned quite a lot of it specifically to create a DEF CON challenge last year for virtualization, which I'll talk about in a second. Now, so what if you want to isolate not processes, but virtual machines? Because you're running virtual machines right now in actually a different way. It's an emulation, so this doesn't apply. But when you run virtual machines on your computer, typically you're virtualizing, you're not emulating. How do you isolate virtual machines where every kernel in those virtual machines assumes that it has direct access to physical memory? You can run DOS in a virtual machine. DOS doesn't know anything, really. DOS was honest. It just let you run your games and didn't get in the way. And now you're forcing it to run inside Windows 11 or worse, Mac OS, or even worse, Linux, right? It's insanity. So what happens? Well, A, you put an extended page table on top of your page table. So you have a four-level, an entire additional four-level translation table that is used to translate guest physical addresses in your virtual machine into host physical addresses in your virtual machine. And it's just fucking nuts. Boom. Actually, one sec. Let's back up 2 slides. I forgot to mention one thing. This virtual address, right? 12 bits, 9 bits, 9 bits, 9 bits, 9 bits. That adds up to 48 bits. That means that even on a 64-bit architecture, you can only address with this current design. Hey, they can introduce a level 5 later. But with the current design, you can only address 48 bits of memory. And your pointers all have to be contained in these 48 bits. There's just no architectural way to address memory higher than 48 bits. All bits here have to either be zero, all 0 or all 1 when you do a dereference. if they're all 1, it just... it basically just has to be a sign extension of this single bit, and then they're ignored otherwise. So when you see kernel addresses, is there still a kernel address? Here, yeah. And when you see this kernel address FFFF, it's just a sign extended 48 byte address where the top byte is 0, so it's a kernel. A top bit is 0, so it's a kernel address. All right. So now, so if they're a mix, Connor asks, if they're a mix of zeros and ones, you will end up with a segmentation fault. It's not a valid address. But Connor's saying, why not let us store stuff there? Certain platforms do. This is how ARM pointer tagging, and I don't know if Intel is working on their own pointer tagging, works. So if you look at ARM pointer tagging, ARM's memory tagging extensions allow you to use the top byte for security storage, which is super, super useful. What's the thing? ARM pointer integrity. Yes, PAC. Exactly. Pointer access control. All of this stuff is clever security solutions that use slack space that's still left around in the pointers. So you can have like some sort of a cryptographic signature. You can have whatever tag you want. We just last week had a paper accepted where we used ARM's top byte ignore feature to basically store object IDs inside the pointers so that we could validate them before code accessed objects that it wasn't supposed to access. All right. Actually, the increasing use of these this memory space or the extra bits for what's it called? For security, I'm guessing probably means that we might never get to over 48 bits of addressable memory, at least not easily. All right, cool. So virtual machine isolation, it's insane. Basically, every virtual machine has its own extended page table, which is a four-level structure. It has an EPTPML4, an EPTPDPT, an EPTPD, and an EPTPT that handles the translation of guest physical addresses into guest virtual addresses, which means that you will end up with, guest physical addresses into host physical addresses. Which means that you have this insane two-dimensional lookup process where you start looking up the PML4 of the guest and you use the PML4 of the guest from that CR3 register in the guest. You look up the physical address in the guest, the guest physical address stored in CR3 using the EPT pointers to figure out the PML4, that PML4's physical address in the host, and then you you use the virtual address to look up the BDPT host address in the guest, the BDPT physical address in the guest, then use the EPT to resolve that into its address in the host, and it's just insane. It's insane. It's just crazy. Okay, anyways, that's a lot of lookups, right? Isn't all of this slow as molasses? Well, it would be if you were doing all of this inside the kernel, but you don't actually. You have a specialized piece of hardware called the memory management unit that does all of this in hardware, and it's super fast. And then it's even faster because whenever it successfully resolves something, it stores it in a cache called the translation look-aside buffer. Of course, this means that things become open to cache side channel attacks, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All right, cool. How does this work on other architectures, right? This is supposed to... How does this work on other architectures? Kind of similarly, right? So AMD and Intel collaboratively at some point invented, or I think AMD did the bulk of this for AMD64, invented this four-level page table. ARM has something similar. You can go and actually read the ARM documentation. But the basic idea, there's a CR3 equivalent in ARM of the translation table something register 0 for the user space addresses, and typically the translation table something register 1 for kernel addresses. Those point to a level 0 or level 3, I don't remember which one is the biggest, which one's the smallest, translation table, which then point to level 1, 2, 3, et cetera, et cetera, right? And it's analogous to PML4, BDPT, PD, and PT, right? Of course, Linux runs both on x86 and ARM, So it has to, base register. Thank you, Dystopia. The translation table base register 0, translation table base register 1. Linux runs on all of these things, so they invented a generic terminology, which is really silly because obviously they didn't expect level 4 to show up, I guess. But basically there's the page table, then there's the page mid-level directory and the page upper directory, and then they ended up getting a fourth level, and they're like, all right, what's higher than upper? So they've been global, page global directory. Linux implements these concepts, but it doesn't implement the memory lookup and caching and stuff. It requires a hardware MMU. So if you ever wonder why Linux doesn't run on like Arduino natively, at least mainline Linux, that's why. But there are forks of Linux, like UC Linux, that do not require an MMU. All right. Why am I telling you all of this insanity? I'm telling you this because by being in the kernel, you can break process isolation. You can break it in real bad ways. So if you have code execution, you're golden. It used to be that you didn't even need to have code execution to break process isolation. If you were root, you could open devmem and literally directly access physical memory. And it was fun. You could search around. You could open up, you know, Vim and put in some text and then search for it in physical memory by opening devmem. Those old days are gone. That's a very big security no-no. No one in their right mind would do that. Devmem still exists to allow you to access certain memory mapped hardware, input-output devices, but it doesn't allow you to access physical memory. Now, if you want to access physical memory, you have to be the kernel, right? And you will be the kernel because you'll achieve code execution in the kernel throughout this module. The kernel has two very useful macros that you can play around with. One macro takes a physical address and converts it into a kernel virtual address. Why is this possible? Because the kernel maps the entire physical memory space. You don't have that much physical memory. I have 64 gigabytes or something, or 128. It's no, this one has 64. So I have 64 gigabytes. That's 64 huge pages. It's not hard to map, right? So you map it into, into a virtual memory space inside the kernel for ease of access. The kernel does this, and thus it can convert between physical, from any given physical to a virtual address. And then it also keeps its own virtual memory contiguous in physical memory, so it can also convert back. Given a kernel virtual address, it can give you back the user space virtual address. Now, it can't do that for non-kernel addresses. It's a giant pain in the ass. I've implemented it for CTF challenges. You have to basically implement your own memory lookup stuff because the kernel uses the MMU like a reasonable person. It doesn't need to parse these things manually. All right. These macros are super simple. There's literally just an offset where they say, okay, hey, it's this address minus OXFFFF blah 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 for vert to fizz, or plus OXFF blah 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 for fizz to vert.